So, see, while discussing about the leaf in the part 3 of the video, I mean, but the third part of the video of the morphology chapter, while discussing about the leaf, due to some technical error, only one point of this was explained there, and two other points of the leaf, the two other parts of the leaf, I had explained, but they were not covered somehow in the video. So that is why I'm making this small video, which will be later joined with the modification of leaf video, right? See, look at this now. You know, the leaf is a broadened photosynthetic structure of the plant body, right? So which will be covering most of the region on the shoot of the plant body, right? And here we identify three main structures in the leaf. Leaf base is one. Leaf base means it is the point of attachment of the leaf to the stem, maybe the main axis of the stem or a branch of the stem, right? So the point where the leaf attaches to the stem, this is what is called as leaf base. There are different types of leaf bases, but now in this diagram, what you're seeing, can you see a little bulged portion in the leaf base? Leaf base ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ leaf ಇಂದು attachment point ಏನಿದೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ bulging ಇದೆ and such kind of bulged leaf base will be called as pulvinous leaf base and such pulvinous leaf base can be observed in, for example, in hibiscus. You know hibiscus? Dasavala, right? And also in mimosa. Mimosa means touch me not plant. So these can be the examples for having the pulvinous leaf base. This can be an important one mark question. What is pulvinous leaf base? Mention the examples. Okay. So pulvinous leaf base means the bulging leaf base or bulged structure of the leaf base will be called as pulvinous leaf base. Examples are these two. And the next one is the petiole. Petiole means the stalk of the leaf. You can see here a small stick-like structure what you are observing immediately after the leaf base, before the starting of the broadened structure. So this part will be called as the petiole, right? See, sometimes you may see some leaves may not be having such petiole or the stalk of the leaf. Have you seen, have you observed the leaves of grass? Have you observed the leaves of the sugarcane plant? See, they look like this. Have you observed? They look like this. You do not see a stalk which helps in the attachment of the leaf to the stem. The leaf will be directly attached to the stem like this. Yes? Such leaves without petiole are called as sessile leaf. Leaves without petiole are called as sessile leaves. Leaves with petiole, so this one, this is called as petiolate leaf. Leaf with petiole will be called as petiolate leaf. Leaf without the petiole will be called as sessile leaf. Remember this point. Okay, it can be an important point. Now, after talking about the petiole, we should know the what is the function of the petiole. The leaf base, somehow it will help in the attachment of the leaf to the stem, maybe the main axis of the stem or branch of the stem, whereas the petiole will help in providing some mechanical support to the leaf. Because see, you know, leaf is a very thin structure in the plant body, made up of very soft tissues, and leaf has to be kept, or it has to be standing in a appropriate angle to absorb the light, right? See this part, what you're seeing, the broadened structure, the paper-like structure, what you're seeing, which is called as a leaf lamina or leaf blade. So this will not have any strong tissues there. In order to keep that in proper or appropriate position, the petiole will help to hold the leaf in position on the plant body. That is what is the function of the petiole, right? And the third one is leaf blade or leaf lamina. That is the flattened or broadened structure that we find in the leaf. What exactly the opened up or the broad flattened structure, green structure, what we see, which mainly takes part in the process of photosynthesis, that structure will be called as what? The flattened broadened structure will be called as leaf blade or leaf lamina. Right, so this leaf lamina will be having a prominent middle line running all across it, and that prominent middle line will be called as midrib. That is the main vein which will carry the food and water conducting tissues, that is the xylem and phloem. They are going to be traveling all across that particular midrib. Okay, and also this midrib will have so many branches there, and they are called as veins and veinlets. They again spread all over the leaves, right? And they also carry the same xylem and phloem, that is the food and water conducting tissues, in order to supply the food and nutrition to various cells and tissues. Okay, so that is what is the function of the leaf blade or leaf lamina. Mainly the function is to spread broadly so that it can absorb the maximum amount of sunlight, carbon dioxide, etc., and actively involve in the process of photosynthesis. Now, when we look at the arrangement of the veins and veinlets on the leaf blade, it will be different in different leaves that we have already considered in the venation. Right? So what is venation? Venation means it is the arrangement or the pattern of arrangement of the veins and veinlets on the leaf lamina or leaf blade. That is what is called as venation. We have already talked about that. Right? And you can look at this, the tip of the leaf, which is called as leaf tip or leaf apex, will be there. Right? And so the outermost line, outermost margin will be called as leaf margin. And this leaf margin, sometimes it will be smooth like this. Have you seen the mango leaf? It will be smooth like that, right? Sometimes it can be, like especially hibiscus leaf, if you observe, hibiscus leaf will be like this. See, the hibiscus leaf is like this somewhat, right? So it will be cut. So the margin is cut. So that is what is called as a incision of the leaf. Again, based on the incision of the leaf, or what to what extent the incision is there, based on that we have again got simple leaf and compound leaf that we have also considered in the one of the sessions, right? So these are the three main regions of the leaf. And apart from this, you are also seeing one more leaf-like structure here, small green leaf-like structure we observe at the base of the leaf. This may not be necessarily present in all the plants. It may be present or it may not be present. And if it is present, that will be called as stipule. It is called as stipule. Stipule is a small leaf-like structure present at the base of the leaf. Okay? See, the function of the stipule is not particularly known, but by looking at the position of the stipule, usually they are present like this on both sides. So we may conclude that they help in holding the leaf once again in the appropriate position there. Right? So sometimes we also say these were supposed to be leaves. That means they are arising from leaf primordia or leaf buds, but they fail to form a complete or entire leaf. That is why they remain such small leaf like structures at the base of the leaves. Okay, so they are called as stipules. So this was the leftover part, and this part will be joined with the leaf modification part. Okay, so try to rearrange the concepts and study according to the sequence that is there in the textbook. So students, we were discussing about the leaf in the chapter of morphology of flowering plants. So in the previous session, we have discussed, we have understood the different parts of the leaf. Along with that, we have also studied about the venation in the leaf, right? So we have learned what is venation, that is the arrangement of the veins and veinlets on the leaf blade or leaf lamina, right? Along with the midrib, how the arrangement will be and what types of venation we have learned in the previous session. Now, in this session, let us consider another two aspects about the leaf. One is types of leaves. Basic types of leaves ಅಂತ ಕಲಿಬೇಕು, ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಫಿಲೋಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಸಿ ಅನ್ನು ಕಲಿಬೇಕು. ರೈಟ್? ಸೊ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಟೂ ಮೇನ್ ಟೈಪ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಲೀವ್ಸ್. ವೆನ್ ವಿ ಲುಕ್ ಎಟ್ ದ ಲೀವ್ಸ್, ಒನ್ ಈಸ್ ಸಿಂಪಲ್ ಲೀಫ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅದರ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಂಪೌಂಡ್ ಲೀಫ್. ಸೊ ಹೌ ಡು ವಿ ಬೈಫರ್ಕೇಟ್, ಹೌ ಡು ವಿ ಕ್ಲಾಸಿಫೈ ದ ಲೀವ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಟೂ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್ ಟೈಪ್ಸ್? ಬೇಸಿಕಲಿ ಈಸ್ ಸಿ, ಯು ವಿಲ್ ಸಿ ವೇರಿಯಸ್ ಟೈಪ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಲೀವ್ಸ್ ಅರೌಂಡ್ ಯೂ. ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಗೋ ಅರೌಂಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಸಿ, ದ ಕೊಕೊನಟ್ ಲೀಫ್ ಇಸ್ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಸೋ ಹ್ಯೂಜ್. Right, banana leaf is different, mango leaf is different, and touch me not leaf is different. So all of these, they are morphologically different, and when you observe them closely, you will see one basic difference there. Nodi, ee kelavondu leaf hegirutte ant helidre, like for example, if you consider a mango leaf, it is like this, right? So you will not see any incision or cut. Leaf blade enide alla, leaf margin enide, adu continuous ide. It is not cut anywhere. But if you look at the hibiscus leaf, how is it? Hibiscus leaf nodta idiri illa diagram alli, it has been cut like this. Andre anchinalli marginalli cut agide, right? But when you look at the other kind of leaf, hunse maradu leaf nodirthiri, how is it? It is like this. Nodidiralva, it looks like this. So here also the cutting is there, cutting of the leaf margin is there. In this case, like in hibiscus also, the cutting of the leaf margin is there. Idukku idukku en vyathasa, what is the difference between the leaf margin cutting in hibiscus and in tamarind, that is hunase mara? So idralli en difference anta helidre, the incision of the leaf is such that it is reaching up to the midrib. I repeat, the incision of the leaf is such that it is reaching up to the midrib. If it is not reaching up to the midrib, then it will be called as simple leaf. If it is reaching up to the midrib, then it will be called as what? A compound leaf. So simple, the simple difference between the simple leaf and compound leaf is what? The incision on the leaf, if it is there, if that incision margin in the adu midrib varage reach aagta idre, see this is the midrib, right? This is the midrib. Midrib varage incision agiddu reach aagta idre, then it will be called as compound leaf. If there is no incision, or even though if there is incision but it is not reaching up to the midrib, then in that case it will be called as what? It will be called as once again simple leaf. So, and the other differences here with respect to the simple leaf and compound leaf, apart from leaf lamina is not incised to reach the midrib. In this case, leaf lamina is incised. Incised means cut to reach to the midrib, forming leaflets. See, this entire structure what you are seeing is only one leaf, okay? And these small green leaf like structures, they are actually what? They are leaflets. See, here I have written they are called as leaflet. So this is entire leaf, it has been cut into small leaf like structures, they are called as leaflets. And all these leaflets, they are either attached to one common axis, that axis will be called as rachis. So this one common axis which runs all along and on which many leaflets are arranged on both the sides, as you are seeing in this picture. So this axis which is running at the center is called as the rachis. Okay, I have written it here, rachis. So on the rachis, on the main axis of the rachis, if leaflets are arranged on the both sides, then such kind of compound leaf will be called as pinnately compound leaf. Pinna, do you know what is pinna? See, you have got two ear pinna. Pinna means it is just an outward projection. See, these are outward projections or protuberances arising from one common axis, right? Iga ondu leaf ide ant heli nodi, this is the main axis. Idrinda on both sides, if you get the leaflets or protuberance on both sides, then such kind of leaf will be called as what? Compound leaf, that is particularly pinnately compound leaf, right? The other type of compound leaf is there, which is called as palmately compound leaf. That means illi rachis irudilla, but the axis of the stem, on the axis of the stem, from one of the points on the axis of the stem, many leaves are attached. Many leaflets, not leaves, there are many leaflets. See, this is one entire leaf. Idu onde leaf idu, but the leaf axis or leaf margin has been cut in such a way that they are meeting at one particular point, so forming many leaflets. So here in this case, leaflets are attached to one common point. So this is what is called as palmately compound leaf. It looks like a palm, right? So palm Because from one point, all fingers are arising. Similarly, from one point, all the leaflets are arising. That is how it is called as what? Palm Idli compound leaf. Remember, this can be an important question for you. Simple leaf, compound leaf are the two different types of leaves. So how are we going to classify them? Simple leaf and compound leaf. The basic difference between these two leaves is the leaf incision. The leaf incision with respect to its margin. ಓಕೆ ಒಂದು ಲೀಫ್ನ ತಗೊಂಡ್ರೆ ಅದರ ಮಾರ್ಜಿನ್ ಮೇಲೆ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಇನ್ಸಿಷನ್ ಆಗಿದೆ ಸೊ ಇನ್ಸಿಷನ್ ಇಫ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಬಟ್ ಇಫ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ರೀಚಿಂಗ್ ಅಪ್ ಟು ದ ಮಿಡ್ ರಿಬ್ ದೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಒನ್ಸ್ ಅಗೇನ್ ಸಿಂಪಲ್ ಲೀಫ್ ಇಫ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ರೀಚಿಂಗ್ ಅಪ್ ಟು ದ ಮಿಡ್ ರಿಬ್ ದೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಎಸ್ ಕಂಪೌಂಡ್ ಲೀಫ್ ಸೊ ಅಗೇನ್ ದೆರ್ ಆರ್ ಟೂ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್ ಟೈಪ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಕಂಪೌಂಡ್ ಲೀವ್ಸ್ ಒನ್ ಈಸ್ ಪಿನ್ನೇಟ್ಲಿ ಕಂಪೌಂಡ್ ಲೀಫ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅದರ್ ಈಸ್ ಪಾಮೇಟ್ಲಿ ಕಂಪೌಂಡ್ ಲೀಫ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಗಿವ್ ದ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಟ್ಯಾಮರಿಂಡ್ For pinnately compound leaf, for palmately compound leaf, you can give the example of silk cotton. Pinnately compound leaf ge neem kuda example kodabodu bevina ele right neem or you can also give the example of mimosa pudica means what the touch me not plant here for palmately compound leaf silk cotton which looks like this right so these are the two examples I have already told you you need to remember the concepts in this chapter along with the examples are very very important in the chapter of morphology of flowering plants try to remember this then the other aspect of this chapter of the leaf is phyllotaxy see venation we have come across venation means what arrangement of the veins and veinlets on the leaf lamina if this is the leaf lamina leaf blade idr mele yav riti arrange agide veins and veinlets annuvantadakke that arrangement of the veins and veinlets will be called as what the venation similarly arrangement of the leaves on the stem or on a branch of the stem if this is the stem maybe main axis of the stem maybe a branch of the stem on which how or in what pattern the leaves are arranged yava pattern alli yava design alli leaves arrange agide annuvantadakke nav enanta kariteve phyllotaxy anta kariteve so the definition of phyllotaxy can be what the arrangement the pattern of arrangement of leaves on the stem or axis of the stem or branch of the stem is called as a phyllotaxy it can be an one mark important question remember what is phyllotaxy can be an important one mark question what is venation can be an important one mark question right so here this can be two or three mark question different types of leaves along with the examples remember right now when we look at the different patterns obviously we will come across three main different patterns one is alternate phyllotaxy second one is opposite phyllotaxy the third one is whorled phyllotaxy the based on the arrangement of the leaves on the stem we have got three different types alternate phyllotaxy opposite phyllotaxy and whorled phyllotaxy what are those it is very simple alternate means what see you are seeing the stem here ee diagram alli thumba clear agide You are seeing the stem, and you know the leaves arise from the nodal region, not from the internode. Idu nimage gottide. On the stem, there are two main parts on the stem. That is node and internode. Node anta helidre, it is the part where many buds are there. From the nodes, the branches of the stem may arise, or leaves may arise, or a fruit may arise, or a flower may arise, or maybe a bunch of flower may arise. So the leaves are arising from the nodes right in such a way that nodi if this is the main axis of the stem anta helidre athwa branch of the stem anta helidre so one on this side the other on this side again the next one on this side the next one on this side right so if this is the axis anta helidre one leaf comes on this side the next leaf is not again on this side next leaf should be here and next leaf should be on the right side one right one left one right one left so this is what is called as alternate so these are alternate with each other the pattern of arrangement is alternate that is what is called as alternate phyllotaxy I hope you are understanding right so one is here and the other is here idu next illi barodilla ee kade barutte and once again next once again here I hope you understand and opposite means what on a single node. See, this is one node, this is one node, this is one node. One node in the opposite directions, two leaves varate. There are two leaves arising from the same node in opposite directions. So, as you see in the diagram, this is what is called as opposite phyllotaxy. This is alternate. In the case of alternate, what happens? One node will give rise to only one leaf in a particular direction. The next node will give rise to another leaf in the opposite direction, right? Whereas in this case, one node will give rise to two leaves. From the same node, two leaves are arising, but in opposite directions. This is what is called as opposite phyllotaxy, alternate phyllotaxy. Once again, examples are very important here. China rose anta kariyodu yavadakke naavu hibiscus, daswada, the common name of hibiscus is what? China rose, mustard, sasve plant, okay, and even the sunflower. So these are the examples for the plants having alternate phyllotaxy. And the plants which are having the opposite phyllotaxy are guava. Guava andre perale. Perale handa gottalva? Guava. So that is the example for opposite phyllotaxy. And even calotropis. Yekke gida anta karitive. Sanna plant irutte. And if you break that plant, adru olagade inda milk oozagadu. Milk halinanta ondu white liquid horagade barutte. So adukke ekke gida anta karitive. So that is what is called as calotropis. This is a scientific name. That is why I have underlined the scientific name here. Mattu examples anna hige nenpittkolbekagutte. And you need to mention the examples as it is whenever asked in the examination. Then the next type of the phyllotaxy here is, the third type is world phyllotaxy. So in the case of world phyllotaxy, what are we observing here? See, this is the axis of the stem and here there is one node. One node ninda, in this case, what did we observe? Two leaves arising in opposite directions from the same node. Whereas here, from one node, one node ninda, adru sutta. So if this is one node, so all around this axis of the stem, completely encircling that node, there are many leaves arising here. See, completely encircling that one node. So this is what is called whorl. Whorl means what? So it is encircling, right? So whorl means they are encircling, they are surrounding that one node and many leaves will arise. Okay, they are definitely more than two and maybe more than four or five. So they are completely encircling that one node. This is what is called as whorl phyllotaxy. And that whorl phyllotaxy can be seen in Alstonia. Alstonia means it is the plant which is used usually in this part of Karnataka, in Udupi, in Shivamogga, Chikmagalur, in the coastal region and in the Malnad region. Aati amavasya barutte. Aati amavasya bandaga ondu plant anna use martivi kashaya madlikke, and that plant, the scientific name of that plant is Alstonia. And if you get to observe that plant, you observe that the arrangement of the leaf is such that it is having a whorled phyllotaxy. Remember, okay, next time aati amavasya bandaga whorled phyllotaxy nim talle barbeku. Okay, keep that in mind. And this is the example, this is the only example mentioned for whorled phyllotaxy. You can remember just one, that is sufficient for you. Right, so these are the different types of phyllotaxy. This is about the types of leaves and phyllotaxy. Now we can move forward with the modifications of leaves, just like how we observed modifications of stem and root. So about the modifications of leaves, just like how we see the modification of the root and stem for various other purposes apart from their functions. See, you know, the stem, actually the main function of the stem is to give the mechanical support and acting as the main axis of the shoot of the plant body, right? And you know, the root, the function of the root is to absorb the minerals and nutrients and also to give support or anchorage to the plant body. But apart from these, the roots and stems, they will also perform other functions such as the storage of the food material or maybe giving protection to the plant body, right? Many other functions are there, maybe respiration roots. So like that, different functions are performed. Similarly, leaves have been modified to perform other functions apart from their main function of photosynthesis. So you already know, it is well understood by you all, that leaves, the main the structure of the leaf or the main function of the leaf is meant for what? trapping of the sunlight and carrying out the process of photosynthesis in order to produce the food material in the plant body. And that food that is produced in the plant body will be utilized for the plant also, plant itself also, and it will be also the food that is provided to the other organisms, the herbivores, right? So apart from that, what other roles or other functions can be seen by the leaves when they are modified for a particular purpose? So one is tendrils. Tendrils bagge neevu stem nadiko kuda kalthidiri, and tendrils can also be seen, similar structures, they are, that is why they are called by the same name. But if they are arising from the stem, if the stem has been modified to act as a supporting structure, a twining structure, a very thin spring-like structure, then it will be called as stem tendril. Remember the examples of the stem tendril, try to recall them. I had mentioned the example for stem tendril, gourds and grapevines. Grapevine, grape andre drakshi plant alli mattu, gourds means what? The bitter gourd it can be, or the which one, ash gourd, pumpkins, or even the cucumber. So these are the examples for having, these are the plants for examples of for having the stem tendrils, whereas the leaf tendril can be observed in plants such as pea, batane athwa watane anta karithivi. Okay, so in this case the leaf will be modified into, see, the stem like structure here. And so because the plant body, the stem is very weak, it needs some kind of support. So these, the spring-like structures, they will twine around a strong support like a pole or something, and so the plant will grow further taller because of the support it is getting with the help of these leaf tendrils. Okay, the main function of the leaf tendrils is to provide what? Mechanical support. Example is which one? P. Okay, this is one type of modification of the leaf that we observe in this case. Then the other type is modification of leaves into spines. Have you seen the cactus? Papaskalli anta karithivi kannadadalli, nenpidya? Have you seen that? See, it looks like this. See, it looks like this, and so it will be having so many thorn like structures on this. Maybe it may be like this, or it can be cylindrically structured like this, right? It will be like this, or, and it will be having so many spine like structures, mullinantaha structure irutte idra mele, all over the body. See, it is a very interesting modification here. The green structure what you are observing, green fleshy structure what you are observing, is basically what the stem which has been modified here. Illi now green structure nortta idivi, that is the stem, but leaves have been modified into small spine like structures. Highly reduced structure of the leaf can be observed here. See, this reduction of the leaf to form the spines, there are two major purposes here. One is providing protection to the plant. Okay, if any grazing animal, so which usually feed upon the plants, if they come near the plant, if they try to feed upon this plant, obviously the plant can be protecting itself. It can have a defense mechanism by having such sharp spine like structures. One purpose, that is protection or defense. There is another purpose. Usually these plants, they grow in desert areas where the rainfall is too less, right? So scanty rainfall area it is, and that is why the availability of the water is very rare, and as a result of which they should not have the broader leaves. Tumba agalavadantaha broad leaf ittu anta helidre, sunlight will be directly falling upon that leaf, and absorption rate or evaporation rate of the water from the cells of the leaves will be much higher. Whereas in this case, where the leaf has been reduced into a very tiny, very hard and spine like structure, definitely there will be no much absorption of the water, there will be no much evaporation of the water, and water can be retained in the body of the plant for a longer duration, for a longer time. It can store the water. So one is for protection, the other main function is to storage or store the water in the plant body. So that is one more leaf modification here, right? Examples yavu nenpittukoltiri? Cacti. So spines in cacti. Okay, so I will show you the pictures and I will show you some models once again for all these stems, roots, ellavukku nan torustene. But for now you need to learn how to draw the diagrams also. That is why I'm going through like this. Later in one of the sessions I will take up and I will show all the pictures and all the models also, right? Then fleshy leaves. Have you seen onion? Have you seen garlic? What do you observe there is, see, if you cut the onion anytime, you will see a central cylindrical structure around which many fleshy leaf like structures are arranged like this. Yes or no? See, this is how in both cases, in onion as well as in garlic means belluli, onion means iruli, right? So in this case, what are you observing is the central cylindrical structure is basically the modified stem. Central cylindrical structure, what you observe is the modified stem, and these fleshy parts from where actually the juice comes out, the flavor of the onion or the garlic is hidden in these layers. And these fleshy structures, they are the modified leaves, mainly for the storage of food. They store a lot of food, they are rich in carbohydrates, right? And that is why we make use of them as one of the vegetables, and because they are highly nutritive, isn't it? So they are the fleshy leaves for storage of the food in the case of onion and in the case of garlic. Remember these two examples, onion and garlic, for the fleshy leaves. Modification of the leaves into fleshy leaves, that is mainly for the storage of the food material. Yes, that is one thing. Then, have you come across the pitcher plant in your lower class? Pitcher plant, kannadadalli hooji gida anta kariteve, or the scientific name of the plant is Nepenthes anta kariteve, right? The plant looks like this. See, the leaf will be like this and it will be modified into a pot like structure, and also it will have some lid like structure like this. Okay, so this lid or flap like structure will be open, and once when the insects fall into this, it will close, right? And so that is when the insects are killed in that plant. See, they are normally called as insect eating plants. Insectivorous plants are generally called as what? Insect eating plants. In fact, the plants will never eat the insect. They will trap the insect, they will catch the insect, they will attract the insects. Once when the insects fall into the trap, the insects are the flap will be closed. So slowly, because of various chemicals, various enzymes released upon the insect in that leaf like structure or in the pot like structure of the plant body, what happens? The insect will be killed. Upon killing the insect, the plant will absorb nitrogen from the body of the insect. It will not literally eat away the insect, but the plant is trapping the insect mostly to absorb the nitrogen from the body of the insect. Okay, the body of the insect will be very rich with nitrogen, and that is why such insects are trapped. This is one plant, that is pitcher plant. Okay, pitcher plant, this is the pitcher plant. And there is one more plant called Venus flytrap. You just go to YouTube and type Venus flytrap, you will see beautiful videos of Venus flytrap. And in fact, the Venus flytrap catching the insects or some caterpillars, etc. So it will be open like this. It will be having thorns, thorn-like structures. And once when the insect comes here, so it will slowly close up like this. So it will just locked up. It will get locked up. And so the insect that will be trapped there, it's going to die, and slowly the plant is going to absorb all the nitrogenous substances from the body of the insect, from the insect body which is trapped. That is a Venus flytrap. Then, see, this is the modification of the leaves for insect trapping. Modification of the leaf for insect trapping. Example, Venus flytrap, and the other one is pitcher plant. I hope pitcher plant nimge idea bantu ankoltini. See, it will be like this. There will be a flap here, and this is actually a continued part of a leaf. See, this is the leaf. Leaf irutte, the leaf will be continued to have a pot like structure like this, or pitcher like structure like that. Okay, so that is what is a pitcher plant. Then the last one, Acacia is most commonly found in the forest areas of Western Ghats, because Acacia is planted, it is a planted one by the forest department just to cover the cut down patches of the forest. ಅಂದರೆ ಡಿಫಾರೆಸ್ಟೇಷನ್ ಆಗಿರುವಂತಹ ಜಾಗದಲ್ಲಿ ಫಾರೆಸ್ಟನ್ನು ಮತ್ತೆ ರೀಕ್ರಿಯೇಟ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ, ರೀಫಾರೆಸ್ಟೇಷನ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ಲಾಂಟ್ಸನ್ನು, ಕೆಲವು ಪ್ಲಾಂಟ್ಸನ್ನು ಫಾರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅವರು ಬೆಳೆಸ್ತಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಚ್ ಪ್ಲಾಂಟ್ಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಅಕೇಷಿಯಾ. ಅಕೇಷಿಯಾ ಕೆಲವರಿಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಇಟ್ ದ ಲೀವ್ಸ್ ಲುಕ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದ ನೀಲಗಿರಿ ಲೀವ್ಸ್. ನೀಲಗಿರಿ ಗೊತ್ತಲ್ಲ, ಸೊ ದ ಲೀವ್ಸ್ ಲುಕ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಿಸ್. ಓಕೆ, ದೇ ಲುಕ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಿಸ್, ದೇ ಆರ್ ಲೆನ್ಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಆರ್ ಲ್ಯಾನ್ಸಿಯೋಲೇಟ್ ಲೀವ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಕರಿತೇವೆ. ದೇ ಲುಕ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಿಸ್. ಓಕೆ, ಸಿ ವೆನ್ ಯು ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವ್ ದಟ್ ಲೀಫ್ ಕ್ಲೋಸ್ಲಿ, when you observe that leaf closely, the leaf is basically, the plant is basically what? It is a dicot plant. The plant is a dicot plant, but still the leaves appear to have what kind of venation? Parallel kind of venation. So just try to recall from the venation part we have learned in this chapter. Venation in the case of dicot plant is not parallel, it should be what? Reticulate. But what we are seeing in a dicot plant, parallel venation. How is that possible? It is possible because it is not a leaf only. What you see, the green structure, the green flattened leaf like structure what you are seeing in Acacia is not leaf only. Then what is it? Where is the leaf then? See, in the younger condition, the leaves will be like this. Leaves in Acacia. Leaves in Acacia are like this, and these leaves in a very young condition, what happens? They will fall off from the plant body. They will fall off from the plant body. Then ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಲೀಫ್ ಇದ್ದದ್ದು ಉದುರಿ ಹೋಯಿತು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ಆ ಲೀಫಿನ ಹಿಂದೆ ಇದ್ದಂತಹ ಪಿಟಿಯೋಲ್, ಯು ನೋ ವಾಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಪಿಟಿಯೋಲ್? ಪಿಟಿಯೋಲ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಸ್ಟಾಕ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಲೀಫ್. ಸಿ, ಇಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ನಾರ್ಮಲ್ ಲೀಫ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ಸಿಂಪಲ್ ಲೀಫ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಪಿಟಿಯೋಲ್, ರೈಟ್? ಬಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪಿಟಿಯೋಲ್, which should be just like a small stick or a small stand like structure for the leaf, it has been broadened here in the case of Acacia. When the leaves fall off, this petiole will itself will act as a broadened leaf like structure for the process of photosynthesis. So the petiole modified to carry out the process of photosynthesis in the case of Australian Acacia. Okay, this is one example also you need to remember, where petioles modified into leaf like structure for the process of photosynthesis. Yes, so these are the various leaf modifications that we come across, and by this we conclude the part of the chapter that is leaf in the chapter of morphology of flowering plants. In the next session, let us take up the next concept, that is the inflorescence.